Hello, my name is Anim Bleier, and together with my colleague Kenan Erdogan, we are going to present you a persistent binder hub, democratizing access to computational resources in the social sciences. I would first like to say a few words about who we are. We work at GESIS. GESIS is a Leibniz Institute and the largest infrastructure institution for the social sciences in Europe. It is headquartered in Mannheim, with a location in Cologne, that is where we work, with basic research-based services on consulting covering all levels of the scientific process. GESIS supports researchers in the social sciences. Examples of our offerings include ssorr.info, an open access repository for traditional paper-based publications, or the data catalog, where social scientists can find the most relevant datasets. Finally, GESIS training offers a wide range of events, especially workshops on empirical research methods. In 2014, we founded the Computational Social Science Department, which aims to analyze socio-cultural phenomena through new kinds of novel data and technologies. The overall goal of the department is to develop and provide methods and tools for the social sciences to mine digital behavior data, to collect sensor data, and to combine this new kind of data with traditional surveys in order to improve the analysis of a broad range of social-cultural phenomena. The department tackles these tasks with approaches from machine learning, text and data mining, as well as network analysis. And I'm sure we all can agree, the Jupyter ecosystem provides the most awesome collection of tools and services to tie all these things together. The literate programming paradigm implemented in the Jupyter notebook allows the combination of human-readable documentation along with analysis code and graphical outputs to construct powerful analysis pipelines. The community service mybinder.org provides instant one-click reproducibility that works just with your browser for repositories hosted via Git, Dataverse or Zenodo, to name just a few. In the last months alone, over 500,000 launches have been carried out for over 28,000 analysis pipelines. And we are proud to be part of the MyBinder Federation that provides the service. Persistency is one of the most widely requested features for MyBinder. And in this talk, we would like to introduce a model of persistency for MyBinder. We would like to share how persistency works for users and how persistency works if you are running such a binder hub. The remainder of this talk consists of two segments. First, I will present the user perspective, followed by Kenan presenting the deployment perspective. Our persistent binder hub instance is hosted at notebooks.gesis.org. So without further ado, let's head over there. So welcome to GESIS Notebooks. To use GESIS Notebooks, we have to either register a new user or log in with an existing user. Since I already have registered, I can just click the login button. We will then be redirected to the persistent binder hub launch form, a version of the MyBinder launch form that holds in addition your already existing projects. Let's insert the URL of a binder-ready GitHub project and add the launch parameter lab to start with the lab view right away. Since this is just a version of Binder Hub as it is deployed on MyBinder, we can click the show button on the build logs to either inspect the build logs or the launch process. After the launch process has finished, we will be redirected to the view of the notebook server with the lab environment loaded. And just as on MyBinder, we will have all the files that are on GitHub in its repository. We can now execute code as we are used to and add new code as we want. However, unlike the traditional MyBinder,
this deployment allows us to make these changes persistent. To do that, we first need to make sure that our notebook is saved. Once I have saved the notebook, I can return to the Hub Control panel. In the Hub Control panel, we now have an additional project in our projects list. The button My Server would allow to return me to my server, and the Stop button allows me to stop the repository. Let's just do that. Also note, each repository has its own commit hash as well as a link to the place where it was cloned from. Let's open that page. Going back to our control panel, we see two projects. Let's delete one of them by pressing the delete button. Please note, this deletes also all associated files. So click the confirmation dialog. Next, let's restart our existing project by clicking the launch button. This triggers the same binder launch routine as usual. However, since we have persisted files, these files can be mounted as an overlay to our Jovian home directory, and we will be redirected once the launch process is over to a Docker file and a Docker image that contains all the stuff we did before. After the redirect, we see again our list of files. However, there is one file changed. Let's open it. And we can instantly recognize it contains the changes from before. However, only the file is changed and saved, not the state of the kernel preserved, so make sure to rerun it. Let's head back to our control panel and import a second project. The first thing we have to do in the control panel is to stop the current project. This is necessary since the persistent binder hub instance at GESIS does currently support only one running instance at any time. Next, I will open a project analyzing all the launches of COVID on my binder in the My Binder Federation. The next thing is I will import that project into the persistent binder hub using a binder and the persistent binder launch link. The launch link works just like any other MyBinder launch link, except this time it's redirecting us to a persistent binder hub instance. In fact, this can be generalized. Every MyBinder launch link can be turned into a launch link for a persistent binder hub. So your MyBinder repository might already work with a persistent binder hub. Let's assume you want to start the binder examples requirements repository. All you want to do and all you need to do to start it on the persistent binder hub at GESIS is to replace the mybinder.org part with notebooks.gesis.org/services/binder. Let's make some small changes since the headline is missing. However, as soon as I start to execute the first cell, I recognize that the dependency of matplotlib is missing. I will have to update the repository and add this dependency. Let's head back to the control panel to do just that. The first thing again is that I stop the server that is currently running. Next, I use a link to open the repository and change the requirement file. adding matplotlib and saving the changes. I will now copy the GitHub URL of that repository and insert it newly into the classical MyBinder launch form. Note, I'm not using the project lists to launch it this time. What is the difference? If I'm using the list or the link in the list your projects, it will always launch with the given commit hash that was given originally when it was first imported. When I'm using the launch form in the MyBinder form, it will launch with the most recent commit hash, unless a different commit hash is given. So, by inserting the link into the MyBinder form, the repository is rebuilt. Once the build process is finished, we will be again redirected. However, this time to an environment hopefully containing our originally missing dependency. Also note, the changes we made to the file are still there. But matplotlib will this time execute. Let's test that by running all the cells. And indeed, we get a great plot of the number of repositories launched per day containing the string COVID in their URL. I would now like to try something different and see if it's possible to access the files we have on a different project on the persistent binder hub. To do that, let's head first over to our terminal and see where we are working. We are currently working in Jovian, that's a directory. Listing all the files gives us the notebooks that are in our current directory. If we head over to projects, we see two directories. The one we are currently working in and the one we have been working before containing the political communication tweets. In fact, the interesting part is this gives us the ability to access the contents of different projects while still preserving the folder structure we know from MyBinder with everything in your home directory mirrored. Let's try something. Let's compare the number of different repositories containing the string COVID launched per day with numbers of tweets containing the string COVID in the German political communications on Twitter. I have some code for that already prepared. We can access the tweets from the other repository using the trick we've just seen by inserting in the path projects/project name and the file we want to access. Now let's execute and see. Indeed, we find more different projects containing the string COVID in their URL have been launched on the days than tweets sent by two political parties in Germany containing the string COVID. That's awesome to see that MyBinder technology is so widespread already.
Thank you, Arnim. Arnim just talked about the persistent binder hub instance that we have at Gezi Notmos. And now I will demonstrate to you how to set up one locally. But before doing that, I would like to talk about the chart repo and then use it to do the local deployment. As you already see, the chart repo exists on GitHub under Gezi CSS organization, and its name is persistent_binder_hub. And this is also the one that we use for the installation of the instance, the persistent binder hub instance that we have at Gezi's notebooks. The first thing probably I should mention about this chart is that it simply configures and extends the binder hub chart so that it adds persistent storage. But this also means that this chart depends on the binder hub chart, and we also know that binder hub chart depends on the Jupyter hub chart. Therefore, it's really important that you know about these two charts and you have already done some work with them, like you have done some deployments, before you want to use the persistent binder hub. Okay, what requirements do we have before installing this chart? First of all, this is a Helm chart, so we need a running Kubernetes cluster. And also Helm itself. Like Helm is the package manager for the Kubernetes, and we use it to install any chart into a Kubernetes cluster. But what do we need specifically for this chart? First of all, for user storage, we need a storage provisioner and also storage class in our cluster. What I mean is, because this is a persistent binder hub, we need a persistent volume for each user where the user data resides persistently. So for this reason, we need this storage class, which uses the provisioner to provision the persistent volumes of the users dynamically. And the second thing we need is an authenticator. Basically, you can use any authenticator which is supported by Jupyter Hub chart. And the default one in this chart, and I guess also in the Jupyter Hub chart, is a dummy authenticator. But this is only recommended to be used for testing purposes. So if you want to use a proper authenticator, like if you want to use GitHub authentication, you can refer to the Jupyter Hub documentation, and for that you can find the link here. I think that was all that I wanted to talk about this chart itself. So now we can start to do the local deployment. And for the local deployment, I would like to use the documentation that we created for the local development, and then we will use a minikube. All right, let me move this documentation to the left side so we have the terminal on the right side, and then we can start. As we already know, first thing we have to do is to create a Kubernetes cluster. We will do this with minikube, and I already installed it on my machine, and when you want to install one for yourself, you can follow this official documentation, which is linked here. And as I listed, because I already installed it, I like to check the version of it. Okay, I have version 1.13.0. This should be the latest right now. Now I can start the local cluster. I don't want to set driver because I want to use the local, not the local, but the default one, which is Docker driver. And I want to keep this version of Kubernetes, which is version 1.18.3. Because this is the same one that we're using Gesis Notebooks cluster. And I would like to use these 4 CPUs and 8 GB because I think this will speed up things for us. Let's execute it. Okay, our local cluster is ready. There's very important thing here, which is it says that it enabled add-ons, default storage class and storage provisioner. This means that our cluster has a default one, and for our persistent binder hub, the class is going to use this default one, so we don't have to define any in this configuration, which is good. And just to be sure, let's check the status of the cluster. And everything looks good, so we can move to the second step, where we install the Helm. We can install both versions 2 and 3, but I will go with the latest one, which is done, it's installed, so let's check the version, which is version 3.3.1. Okay, now we can clone the repo itself. We need to do this because, for example, we want to use the configuration file for the local deployment, which is available in this repository. And for the recording, I also would like to print the commit that we are working on right now, so we know where we are. And then I can go on with the fourth step, where we run this minikube IP command, and this command gives us the IP address of the local cluster. And as I already said, we will use this configuration file for the local deployment, and we have to edit it with the right IP address that we just got. So I open it, and first thing I like to change is the URL of the Jupyter Hub. And here you see the hub URL already has a port number here, 30123. How do we already know it? Because when we check the service settings of Jupyter Hub, we see that it has service type not port, and then it has this port as HTTP. So we know that it's going to work there. This is the same for the binder service. It also has type not port, and then the not port has the value 30124. This is okay. And now we are going to use this value in this setting. Here's the settings of the Jupyter Hub services. Here's the binder. And first we fix the IP here. And the port is already correct. This means when we set this URL setting, we can reach the binder service through the Jupyter Hub. So when I fix this, and here we have the port where the Jupyter Hub runs, because we can reach through it Jupyter Hub under pet services slash binder. The last important thing I like to mention is that for the authentication, we don't set any type. This means that we want to use the default authenticator, which is dummy authenticator. So now I can set and exit the configuration for local deployment and continue with the fifth step. On the fifth step, first we fetch the required charts, which are Binder Hub and Jupyter Hub. This is done, and now we can create the namespace where we want to install the persistent Binder Hub. It's also created, so now we can run the helm install command. Here, as you see, we use the configuration file that we just edited, and we installed it inside this namespace that we just created. We executed, it's done, but the pods are not ready yet, so let's watch them. They're in container creating status because these Docker images of them have to be pulled into Minikube cluster. Okay, now all three pods have status running, which is good. This means that our persistent binder hub is ready, and we can get the URL of the persistent binder hub we just deployed with this command. And we can copy a link and open it in the browser. Okay, we are welcome with the login page. And because we have the dummy authenticator, we can just type here anything. I use test and then any password. I just type it and I go full screen. So we are here on the homepage of Persistent Binder Hub. I didn't just talk about this interface, so I'm not going to talk about it. I will just pick a repository that I want to build and launch. And I want to pick it from binder examples. And I like to use these requirements. I paste the URL of it here, and then I click on launch. Because this is a fresh deployment we just did, it's going to build it from zero. Okay, the image is built and the user server is being launched. We will be redirected very soon. Okay, we are there. And now let's open the notebook file here and edit here. Let's say 1 + 1, which makes 2. And then go to homepage and then stop the server. And because I want to log out, and logout button is exactly behind my head, so I just log out, move it to the left side and then log out, and then let's log in again with the same user and any password I type, and we are back. We just launched this repo, so I want to launch it again and check if my changes are still there. Okay, because the image is already built, this time it was quick, and then I open the notebook file and my change from the last launch is there. So I go back. And I think that is all that I wanted to demonstrate. We made a development deployment and everything is just working. And with that, I think I'm handing over back to Arnim. Thank you.
Thank you, Kenan, for that great demonstration. And thanks for listening in. What are the next steps you can do? If you enjoyed our demo, give it a try. at notebooks.gears.org. Registration is free for all non-commercial use. However, it's still a beta version, so make sure you always have a local copy of your data. If you find a bug or have an idea about what we can do next, submit a bug report or a feature request. Last but not least, we would like to say thank you for staying throughout this talk with us. And we would like to say thanks to the big and awesome MyBinder community and the great team behind it. It's an honor, a pleasure to be a part of it.